Sebastian, welcome.
Yeah, if you're ever nervous before a talk, just pay some people to cheer you on, and everything is a little bit easier up here. I want to talk about atomic fusion in large projects. This whole concept has been introduced about 2 years ago, has been around for a while now, and I think many people of you already use it. Some don't. And what I want to show you today is some best practices we derive from our work with the concept and how we use atomic fusion in our large scaling projects. And I know that many people of you, or that many people here on these conferences, are coming from various different backgrounds. As I said, some of you might have used atomic fusion before, some don't. I can't give you an in-depth introduction here because the time is pretty short, but if you're really interested in using this and using this in your project as well, watch the last years or 2 years from 2 years before the talks from Martin Fitzer. They gave a great introduction of how to use atomic fusion. He gave a good introduction about the whole principle. What I want to start now with are some core principles so that you have an idea of what we are dealing with here. First one is the separation of concern. We want all our components to have one single concern, and we distinguish two types of components. First of all, the presentational components. They are just concerned with how things look. They know the layout, they know the CSS classes, they know maybe the HTML, something like this, but that's all they know. They don't know anything of concrete data or something. They just open up an API where you can put some data in, and they will render the content somewhere. And the other one is the mapping component. This is where the concrete data comes in. That component knows exactly which data to use, knows which presentational component to use, and it knows which data goes where in the API of the presentational component. Next principle is the principle of isolation. You don't want your especially your presentational components to be dependent on context. So every time you use one presentational component and you put the same data in, you want the same result coming out of it. And also, you don't only want the same result coming out, but you also want them to be completely side effect free. And the last principle is the principle of aggregation. All your presentational components, or let's say the more complex presentational components, they are just sets of smaller or simpler components. It's just a composition of different smaller or atomic components, the very low-level components, and they form the more complex component. So, why do we bother with all this extra work? What are the main advantages we have from this new concept? I always try to find a way to connect it to something everyone can understand. And with this one, with these components, I decided to go for food, because food, everyone knows food, everyone likes food. And I want to compare it to, not the burger, a little bit to the burger, but most of all to one of those big burger chains like McDonald's or Burger King, because there are some pretty good similarities there. First of all, why do people go to McDonald's? They don't go to McDonald's because the food is good, it's very good. It's not. But they go there because they are really reliable. They know exactly when you go to McDonald's here in Dresden or you go to McDonald's somewhere in San Francisco, you know exactly what you get when you order your Big Mac. It's just always the same and you know exactly what you get, and this is what you have with the presentational components. You use them, you know exactly what you get. And all these burgers, they are also made of reusable parts. The whole patties are just they are all the same if you are on the Big Mac or on the hamburger or on the cheeseburger. They just reuse all these components in different bigger components, the burger itself. And also, they are really independent. Because you don't You don't make the burger as a whole. You can make single parts in parallel and then put them together to a burger, which makes the food the process of making this food much, much faster. And all this are really, really good advantages of this atomic fusion principle. And this also has some influence on your development process. Because your development process has to change, or doesn't have to change, but normally changes, especially when you go for larger projects, and because you have much more separated development steps. You don't need one person to make it all. You don't need one person to make one of those big node types that has some mapping in it and some presentation in it. You can split all these steps up. You might have one person from the front end department who makes the presentational components. He doesn't need to know much fusion, a little but not much. On the other hand, you have someone who makes all the data or gets all the data, maybe imports it from some third-party system. And at last, you have someone who stacks it all together. Mostly, this is one of the guys before. And this process or this last step is a little bit after the other two, but the other two can run in parallel. You don't have to wait until one is finished to start with the other. The last one, yeah, it's a little bit afterwards, but even then, when the guy who gets the data also makes the mapping to the presentational component, your front-end department can already start by developing new presentational components. So you get much more independent. You can use much more developers in your projects to do different stuff. And also, you have separated responsibilities. Because there's always one guy you know where to go to who knows how all of this works. Before, it was like when you had one of those big node types, the best thing to do was to go to the one who invented it or who wrote it. And now you can go to your front-end department and say, hey, I want to change my presentational component, because they don't need to know anything else than their front-end part, and this is what they do good. And the same with the data components or with the mapping components. You just go to the guy who does the mapping or who does the integration, who gets the data, and he knows exactly how to change the mapping components. He doesn't need to think about what do I change something in the layout there or not, because that's not happening, because they are so separated that they don't really mix, or they don't really change each other. And the last thing, the teams scale much better, because you know exactly where you need more manpower. Is it the presentational components? Is it the data components? You can, if there's not enough power in your front-end department and you need some more power there, some more men there, you can just add one to this one, or to this department, and scale this one up. And because it's not this mixed node type like we had before, it's much easier to get into it, to learn from it, and also to get into the project. You don't need so much time to get to know the project and everything, because these presentational components, for example, all work the same. So let's come to some of our best practices. And especially the developers, for them, much will be everyday work, especially the first point of the clean API. But these things I have to mention because they are so important, especially when you're working on large projects, because you don't want to lose time to bad written code or to bad written API. And the first thing we have here, if you want to write the mapping for this component, it's a pretty small one, and if you want to write the mapping for this, you have to go to the renderer and you have to look it up, which props are there, which props can I use. That's not what you want. What you want is something like this. You want to see explicitly what is my API and what can I put in there, and how, because you are not concerned, as the one who's writing the mapping, what's going on in the renderer, and you don't want to be concerned with it. And it's also a good idea always to show which data types you have to put in there. So don't set all the values to null, because null can be everything. But start out, a label, of course, that's a string, or the open a new window, of course, it's a Boolean. This all seems pretty obvious, but for the guy who wants to write the mapping for this, it's not obvious at all. And when you have a look at this component, it's also pretty good. You know exactly there's a list title coming in. That's some kind of string. You know that there are list items. And you know that's an array of some kind. And you have the order list. That's a Boolean. The problem here is you don't really know what my items look like. You know that there's a loop somewhere in there, maybe. And yeah, this renders something. But you don't know what these single items look like. For this one, it's pretty easy, but this is just an example. These items can become pretty big. And what we do here is we just write this little extra, it's a little extra component just to show the API. It doesn't give you an advantage most of the time, but you can just have a look at that and see, okay, this is how the data of my component, or the data of the items I put in there, this is what it looks like. And if you use in this place, it's pretty hard, but if you have really big components, you can even use different ones, different data components, and set default values, for example. Next thing are the modifiers. Normally in projects, you have a lot of different buttons, default buttons, small buttons, big buttons, primary, secondary, whatever. And the easiest thing to do would be something like this, just to add a modifier class. Yeah, and then you can change the button the way you want. The problem is, first of all, you have no idea what this modifier class looks like. You have to look it up in the CSS, which classes you can put on there. And on the other hand, you could put in everything. You can just put in class that's coming from a totally different component. And then the different component is changed, and suddenly all is broken because you didn't use it the correct way. And it's really hard just by a modifier class to show what these modifiers are. And what you can do is, sometimes you can't get rid of the whole string process, especially if you have different sizes. You can use a Boolean for this always, but that's a lot of code you have to write there, and that's not what you want. But that's always the easiest and the best way and the most controlled way of setting classes to your component, or changing the looks of your component. But what you can do, and this is what we love to do, is first of all, we split all the modifiers up so that you see exactly what you do in there, what you what's the change you make when you use this modifier. And the next thing we do is we combine it with our block class in the renderer, because like that you can prevent from putting any class in there and hoping that it will never change. Next up is bundle-related props. When you write, especially when it comes to more complex components, you end up with a really big API, and you put all everything you need on the basic, on the root level, and you end up with this long list, and it's not really easy to read, it's not really easy to get what you have there, and then you have to map all these props from your parent component, maybe to a child component where the names are different. What you can do is, you just do something like this. You add data structures for your subcomponents, or maybe even for just some parts of the component, so that it's much, much easier to read. You know exactly what belongs where. You can use the same naming as in your child component. And as you see here, you don't even need to map this, all the props to the child component. Then you can just use an AFX. It's a spread operator. If you write Pure Fusion, you can use apply. And it makes the code much shorter, but that's not even the best solution. Because what we normally do is, I told you about the data components before, and what we do is something like this. We just use this little data component in there, and in the modern IDE, just click on it and you see exactly what you have to put in there. Which makes the API of a single component much smaller, but still shows off exactly what gets in there. The next thing, and this is something, especially when you start out with Atomic Fusion, you see a lot of components and you see they are all pretty different, pretty similar. As you see, we have totally different types of teasers here. All have an image, all have a headline, all have a text, and some kind of link. I don't know if it's not obvious, but this is not a real project. My designing skills, I think they show it off. But I just made it for here. And I also wrote the fusion component or the presentational component for all these teasers, if I put it all in one component, and it looks something like this. It's really hard to read, especially in the back there, but even if I set a correct or better font size to this, it's really, really hard to understand because there's so much logic going in on there, and it's really hard to read that code. So let's have a look at these components again and think about what's really similar about them. Yeah, they all have one image, they all have a headline and a link and maybe a text, but that's just how teasers work. Every teaser has something like this. That doesn't mean they belong together or they are the same component. Try to take a step back at this point and look, especially if your code gets too long, if they really belong together or if there's some semantic combination there. Because when the customer comes to you and says, hey, I want something changed, they normally don't say, hey, I want all my teasers changed. But they want to change special types of it. And what you can do is sort them a little bit by their function. And when the customer comes to you, he says, hey, I want to change the way my products look on the page. And this is the way you divide the components. It doesn't make much sense to put it all in one. And try to get one component that fits all. Even if you reuse styles, this is the point where I say copying some code or reusing or whatever is okay because it makes the maintainability so much easier. It's much easier to maintain. You can add stuff or remove stuff much easier without having to look out for every component for every case this one is used. And now we've been a lot on the representational side. Let's look at the mapping side a little bit. Data aggregation. Again, I can show you one of my little data components that's just inheriting from a data structure. And what you can do is something like this. You inherit from this little data structure. Normally, this doesn't give you much... it doesn't make it easier to read or something, but again, in the modern API, you just click on this component and you see exactly where all the properties come from, where all the props come from you use in there. And what you do here is you just put the mapping itself in a different component, and then you can use it like this. Especially for images, this is we use it a lot because we don't use a simple image normally. We use responsive images. You have to generate all the source sets and all the widths and all this data gets so big that you have to make your own component out of it to reuse it. The other way would be copying it around and then you change your presentation and everything's broken. So use these little data mapping components. You can do it a little bit better even. I just wanted to make it a little bit simpler here. You can add an API to them as well so that you set the node from the outside and don't rely, what we do here is relying on the context node. This doesn't have to be like this. You can even write it a little bit different. Next point are fragments. Fragments, I've used them a lot. I've never heard them before preparing for this talk because where I saw them first is in the new Neos demo package because they use fragments a lot as well. Especially in documents. Normally, these documents get really, really long. You have some kind of head where you maybe override something, you have the body where you have the header and the footer and all the content, maybe some fixed content in there, and those get really messy and really big. So just take some of the small parts, for example the header, and put them in a different file, in a different single component, and what you get out is something like this. Makes it so much easier to read, and if you want to change the header, you know you have to look in that file, or you just click on it on the prototype again, and your IDE points you directly to that file. And you can also do this, and this is especially useful for multi-site installations. For example, for fav icons or for style sheets or something like this, you can reuse this component in every package just have to change the package name and make sure that your fav icons are in the same place. And you get exactly the fav icons you need for this special site package. This is a big advantage over writing all those paths again and again and again. And last but not least, you can also use all this component stuff for caching. You might have something like a news list that uses the node. You have to add all the cache tags, the node, the document node, and maybe all the news document nodes. And maybe on another page, or you have a different type of news list, and they all use the same caching or the caching entries. And what you can do here again is you put it in your own cache tag prototype and reuse this cache tag prototype. The only thing you have to look out for is that it has the correct format. This is why this process flatten is the processor is on there. And I could go on with showing you examples of how to reuse stuff, but I think you got the main concept here. Don't repeat yourself. Don't repeat yourself too often. Try to take everything and put it out in a single component. Even if you don't reuse it, you have it there on hold. Maybe you'll need it sometimes later. And it makes your code much easier to read, much more readable, and reusable. Now, the last point I want to come to is how to avoid regressions. This is something I was really thinking about last year, and because we had one of those large projects, we were refactoring a lot in there. Or if a customer comes and says, hey, I want my button to change, but only in a special place, or something like this, and then you have to test all the components that use the button, and then you have to test all the components that use the components that use the button, and so on. And in every project, there's one guy. Normally, he comes in a little bit later, but he's there. And at the moment when you say, hey, I'm doing this refactoring, he says, wait, there's this component, and that uses a subcomponent, and this uses the button, because he knows everything in this project. That's not me. I don't know what I had for breakfast this morning. I already forgotten that, and I already also don't know all the components in my project. So I was thinking about, is there a way to test this? And what I came up, or what I remembered, is I'm using React a lot as well. And they use Jest as a testing framework, and they have snapshot tests. And snapshot tests are, pretty simple. You define your set of tests, or your set of props in our case. You render the output of these different props, and you save this snapshot somewhere in your file system. You can check it in your Git or whatever. And then later, you change the code, or you refactor the code, or whatever. And when you're done with this, you compare your snapshot to the current version of the output. And you see exactly if something has changed, if all is the same. You don't always... This isn't really a test of functioning, but at least you see something has changed, and at least you can check the file again. Is it okay that's changed there or not? And I was thinking about this, and I was reusing a little bit of the code of Monocle. Well, I was checking out the code of Monocle from Zeitgeist. It's a style guide, and they use prop sets already so that you can show different versions of it. And I thought about maybe there's something in there that I can reuse. And this is what I did. And I came up with a new... you can use a different annotation. It's a testing annotation. But you can also reuse the style guide annotation from Monocle. And there's a little package that creates those snapshots. And as you see, you have a little command line implementation that checks these components, these saved snapshots to the current components. You have a little backend module. This is pretty beta still, but you can compare the code in there. You can compare even the rendered output with styles and everything. If everything is still all right, as I said, it's still pretty early. It works. I've tested it with, I think, about 2,000 components we have in one project, and it runs through pretty good. Just as a hint, if you want to add some testing to your components, have a look there and contribute, because I'm more of the front-end guy. I know a little bit now about how the Fusion renderer works, but yeah, if you want to contribute, do it, because I'm not an expert in all this back-end stuff. So let's come to a conclusion. I did this before already a little bit. Don't reuse. Don't repeat yourself. Reuse this way. And try to really make the code easily readable, put everything in different smaller components, that it's much easier to maintain your code. And yeah, especially for large projects, this is a big advantage here. Thank you.